Hello and welcome to the show with me, Gillian Gartzell. Now, in Wicklow Good News, we're talking with a local businesswoman, Kelly Chung, who is the owner, co-owner and operator of Amphibian King. Kelly, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me on here, Jill. It's a nice, it's a welcome change to what our norm has been over the last few weeks anyway. So yeah, good to chat.
Cool. Yeah, that's great. So tell me, before COVID-19, tell me a little bit about your company, Amphibian King. It's a running shoe specialist, is how you, I think you describe yourself.
That's right, yes. So my husband and I, we run a small business together. So the name of the business is Amphibian King. We're what we call its technical shoe specialists. So we set up our first store in Bray. It's almost 14 years ago. So we were very fortunate that we traded very well through a recession. So so basically it is essentially we sell runners and running accessories. We're a running store. Everyone on the team is running mad, you know, whether it's triathlons or marathons or ultra marathons. So really it's gait analysis is what we do. So people come in and we spend half an hour with each person.
So what is gait analysis? Explain that to me, please.
Yeah, so what we would like to do, we tend to do is we have a look at someone who comes in, and gait analysis is really looking at how somebody's foot naturally falls. So you and I, we might wear the same size shoe, but you know, the way we, our biomechanics are, we could be walking very, very differently. So we would actually need to wear different shoes, whether we're walking or whether we're running. So it's really to look at whether you're neutral. I mean, this is the technical terms, whether you're a pronator or whether you need a stable shoe, but really it's looking at what is the right footwear for your unique biomechanics, essentially.
Okay, so you're all mad runners, I say, from park runs up to, I think your husband in particular, he's Ironman specialist, and he's very, very keen on the on all his running.
Yes, so my husband Damien McKeever, so he's, I suppose he's the face behind the business. He's on the front line, if you like, of the business. So he'd be well known, you know, within the running and triathlon community. So yeah, like, I mean, everybody on the team that we've, we're very lucky. We've had some wonderful, you know, people that have worked with us, you know, over the years. And so everybody involved is, yeah, into running. And I suppose you could say some are running nerds, but, you know, I suppose some don't mind being called that. So actually, when the, I suppose, COVID-19 sort of first kind of hit the weekend of the 14th of March. So Davey, my husband, I mean, the only thing he could do really was he decided then, he was going to run 4 miles every 4 hours for 40
minutes. I read that. It's called a David Duggan challenge, I think. Is that right?
It was David Goggins. It was a guy.
Oh, Goggins. I misheard him. Yeah. Goggins. Okay.
So he's somebody who my husband follows, and he's an ex-Navy SEAL, extremely strong guy. So he decided, look, why not? You know.
I mean, it's 4 miles every 4 hours for 48 hours.
That's correct. Yes. Wow. Yeah. So initially when he first told me, I just kind of I was only half listening really, but I suppose the reality hit when I suppose the alarm was going off at 1 a.m. and then at 4 a.m. again, I was thinking, oh God, this is going to be a tough 48 hours. But he split it up. We split it up quite well where, he, you know, some of the daytime runs, this is back when the children were allowed to kind of go out with him. So, yeah, the kids would kind of run, it's, I think, 4 miles, it's around 6 kilometers, would kind of join him for some of the daytime ones. And then, obviously, during the night, he'd go on his own. And then for his very final one, then a friend of his did join him for the very last one. So it was nice, you know, it was nice for him to do that for his own, I suppose, sanity as well. But these are things that he kind of enjoys. He enjoys those things.
Well, I think it's interesting when I was reading that, not that I wanted to do that challenge, thank you very much. I don't run anyway, but it does point up how important physical exercise is for our mental health. And that was your husband, Damien's response to the COVID. And as a small business, I understand you're non-essential, isn't that right? You're deemed to be non-essential as a running shoe shop.
Correct. So we're, I suppose, initially, I mean, this was kind of evolving so, so quickly. It was very difficult to know what we were allowed and not allowed to do. Certainly, we actually decided as a family and as a business to close the doors initially on the first weekend. I suppose this is kind of when the weekend, when the schools first closed, because I suppose we debated back and forth. At the time, we weren't asked closed or anything like that, but we kind of felt, okay, you know, just for ourselves, that maybe we should do something small to help stop the spread of the virus. So we did close. We did operate a click and collect service for those first few days. And then obviously things were changing so quickly that then eventually we got to the stage now, from the announcement that was on the 27th of March, that we're deemed as non-essential, therefore we can't open. So I suppose when you're so used to we're open 7 days a week, and when you're really told it's kind of the opposite to what you know and what you do, it's kind of difficult to know where we're going to be, you know, in the future. So we just have to take it a day at a time.
Now I understand, if people want to order, they can order online and then they'll be delivered. There's no one coming to the shops anymore.
No, so the close. Yes, yeah, so we have two physical stores. So both of those are actually closed at the moment because we're deemed as non-essential. So we will, we will abide by that until we're told that that's going to change. So hopefully it won't be too far into the future. So, but our online store is still operating. So we have products that are up online, so people can browse and purchase online. It's the website has been It's structured. It's not something we're lucky that we then all of a sudden had to mobilize. It's something that was already there, the platform was already there. So yeah, so there's no problems at all. So yeah, we'd love for people to visit the online store, and we will do local deliveries around sort of the Bray, Greystones area. And then of course we'll send items by on post as well.
So it's kind of cool. We're hoping that local people who need to buy their gym shoes will come to you still, or via online. How are you doing with your staff? Is that a problem, or is that, how are you coping?
Yeah, I mean, I think for us, we've had a great team, over the years. We've been extremely lucky with the team that has, worked with us over the years. So we have, we had quite a few part-timers that we had to let six of them. I suppose it's a temporary layoff, if you like, because we're a bricks and mortar store. So if we're not physically opened, there is no work that's there. Mm-hmm. So for now, we're hoping it's going to be temporary, and we'll keep in touch with the team are great. So hopefully, when the time comes that we can sort of pick things up, it's not going to be in the same capacity. We kind of do understand that it's probably going to be quite a slow and a long way to go. But I think kind of in the future, yeah, we hope to be able to kind of work with a lot of the guys that we have on the team.
Yeah. And one of the reasons why we're chatting, because one of the things that caught our eye here on Wicklow Good News is that you want to help back with the frontline workers. Tell me a bit about the project you're doing there.
Yeah, I suppose this kind of really followed on from the announcement that was on the evening of the 27th of March from the government that deemed us as non-essential, therefore we weren't allowed open. So I suppose sometimes when that happens, it's like it's fear, you get fear, you don't really know what is going to happen in the future. And then really, I suppose I thought, the antidote of fear is faith, and we have to really look at what's out there from a faith point of view. And gosh, I mean, we can't open, but people that are working on the front line in the hospitals, in any of the care homes, anything like that, and all the supermarkets, for them to continue doing what they're doing, it really is amazing. So whilst we can't operate and we can't control that, really, I suppose during that night, I didn't really sleep too much that night, thinking, worrying about our own future in our own business. But then I thought, gosh, but these are people that are still continuing on. No questions asked, anything like that. So I just said to Damien the next day, I said, look, I think let's, it's a very small, it's a small pick me up. It was just more so so that, yeah, anyone can nominate, anyone
so
that they.
Tell me about the actual, what you're offering. Tell me what
yeah, so it was just a little a competition, if you like. It's not competition, but it was more that people could nominate family and friends. This is via social media, so we had it over Facebook and over our Instagram pages. So you could nominate a friend, family member that's working either in essential services or frontline, that really deserves a bit of a pick-me-up. So the person that was nominated would receive a pair of new new runners from us, and then the person that has gone to the trouble of thinking of them to nominate them would also get a pair as well, so they'd have a matching pair of runners to I suppose use over the next.
It's a lovely thought, and I went on your Facebook page. A lot of actually, I knew some of the people who were nominating other people too as well. And you've chosen your first recipient. I understand it'll be an ongoing thing. You'll do it on an ad hoc basis, but it's nice.
We'd love to do. I mean, it's as well. I think for us as well. I think especially at the moment with everything that's happening around us and things that are changing so quickly, social media can at times, you know, be a little bit negative at times, and I get that people are probably, you know, we're all going through our own difficulties, but I suppose for us it was actually just wonderful to receive positive messages, so many hundreds and hundreds of positive messages, and even just, you know, people thanking their friends or thanking people that they don't know that well, somebody that works in their local supermarket, you know. And actually it was just lovely, just really to be, I suppose, bombarded with just pure positive messages, and it was just heartwarming for us. So I suppose for us, actually, we're thankful for everyone for nominating. So no, it's been great. You know,
it was, and I read through them; they were lovely, and say different reasons. And it was just, you know, it's almost like a page of gratitude. People saying, "I'm really thankful to this person because they're doing this job so well." So it was amazing. I also know you had a really clever app up to help people who are running. It's you were mentioning a 2 kilometer radius app. That's clever. Oh. So if you're running.
Yeah, so that was something, I suppose, once the 2 kilometer radius rule was put into place, we kind of found it was a very useful app.
Especially if you're running, I think you're walking, you maybe even more sense of your distance. But running, you might get outside the perimeter faster and be in trouble. I also saw, I was stalking your Facebook page today, and I love you had a clip of a man in France running a marathon on a 7 meter balcony. I've seen quite a few of those now, people running marathons in ridiculously small spaces, you know, their living room and stuff. And it's a bit of fun, and it's also keeping active because some people can't get out of their apartments or their houses. Maybe they're cocooning. I thought that was so cute. And I love the children. And they were dancing, a picture of your children, and they wanted to get in the swimming pool. So they were dancing in their swimming costumes. And that was so sweet. It was lovely. And I have to ask you, the last question I'm going to ask you, who is the Kenny Rogers fan?
Oh, well, that is definitely my husband. he surprised a lot of people. I think a lot of people were surprised to hear that he was into country music. But yes, he is very much into country music.
And he's blasting to his heart's content because no one can tell him to turn it off because there's no one in the shop.
None of our team are there to tell him to turn on, because most of our team are actually kind of, I suppose, they'd be hipper, if you like, you know. So, you know. Yeah, so we'd get a bit of slagging for listening to country music, but it's all good. It's all good.
Cool. And actually, I just want to finish off with one thing. Your family have been involved in the community. And just tell me a little bit about your daughter's Stitches with Love project. Just finish on that, please.
Yeah, so this is something we've always been, over the years, been involved with various, voluntary, you know, if it's programs or just really just helping out in any small way that we can. Actually, prior to, COVID-19 hit, I was due to start an induction program to volunteer once a week in St. Joseph's in Shankill. So that, unfortunately, has just been put on the back burner for now. So hopefully, you know, we can kind of pick that back up again quite soon into the near future. But yeah, with the Stitches with Love, I suppose this is a project that we set up, it's probably about 18 months ago, where my daughter, she likes to help out, and she likes to be innovative as well. So I was doing a bit of work with some kind of homeless charities and that. So she and her friends wanted to knit scarves and snoods and buffs. So yeah, they managed to, I think it was something like 200 that they did knit, and we went out. Then there was a mobile homeless kind of table, a home, you know, for our rough sleepers, where they do offer meals and things like that just outside Dunn's on Grafton Street. So all the kids got to go in and you know, hand out, you know, it's small things. They're just small things that we can do to help the community and the wider community.
Well, it's great that they I knitted all those scarves and stuff for the home. It's a really, it's a nice, a very personal touch from a young person then to also respect somebody who's in a very difficult situation. So no, really nice. And hopefully, as you were saying, now things are quieter, maybe you could get back into this, into that project again, to help the homeless who need it more than ever.
That'd I think cool. so. I mean, it's, I think we all live such busy lives, and especially, you know, with children nowadays, there's so many activities going on that it was something that we probably just left down for a bit. And certainly now at the moment, we've got a lot more time on our hands. So I think that's something we could pick back, you know, pick up again quite easily, actually, because Grace, she's very good actually on the sewing machine. You know, a lot of the things that she's made is she's actually just Googled on YouTube. So I don't have a craft background at all. So if anything, she's taught me how to crochet and things like that. So it's great, you know, it's great. So I think definitely once I get a handle on the homeschooling, I think, yeah, we can start taking out the sewing machine again and maybe, yeah, do
some, making some masks.
Yeah, my husband, that's not a bad idea. He mentioned that, and it's something where, yeah, we need to look that up and hopefully see if it could be something that we could do. But as I say, I suppose not being from a crafty background, I'm not really sure how to supervise it. But no, as I say, look, Grace is she's very resourceful, so I'm sure she, you know, she'd be able to figure that out from a YouTube tutorial. So that's
brilliant. Well, it's been a pleasure chatting with you today, Kelly, and I love what you're doing, and I hope your business survives because it's obviously grown with love and care with a great team. I hope the locals will be able to support you because we need new shoes as we're walking to try and keep ourselves fit and mentally healthy. And I love the idea, you keep on saying it's a small thing, but it's a lovely thing to encourage people to nominate other people to show gratitude, and even that alone is a really good positive thing to do. It's good positive social media, and then suddenly when someone actually receives the runners, that's a great idea. So thank you very much for your time today, Kelly, and we hopefully we'll be chatting you at the far side.
Thank you very much, it was a pleasure.
Thank you indeed. That was Kelly Chung, who's owner and operator of Amphibian King in Bray and Ballymount, and talk about that wonderful idea. You're listening to me, Julianne Gotts, along Wicklow Good News, produced by Marlena Murphy and sound by Gavin Dowd. Any other ideas of heroes out there in the community? Tell me what people are doing. Do let us know, and we'd love to feature them. Thank you very much indeed.